Okay, thank you everyone for joining today. This week, I am pleased to announce our TSVP lecture is going to be given by Professor Kyoji Saito. Professor Saito has had a very illustrious career in Japan. So he first studied as an undergrad and a master's student in the University of Tokyo. He received his PhD from Göttingen University in Germany, and has since had several research positions at the University of Tokyo and at RIMS in Kyoto University. RIMS is the Research Institute of Mathematical Sciences, which is very famous, at least here in Japan, and probably quite famous in mathematics abroad as well. Currently, he's a professor emeritus of RIMS and also associated with IPMU at the University of Tokyo. His prizes include receiving the Geometry Prize of the Japan Math Society in 2011. So we're very happy to be joined by Professor Saito, who is currently working sort of at the interface of algebraic geometry and some mathematical physics applications, I think. So please join me in welcoming Professor Saito.
Is it on now? Okay, thank you very much for the introduction. And so I'm going to talk about what I call Platon symmetry. This is something geometric talk. And I should, before starting, I should give three apologies. One is, this is mainly about some history of mathematics related to this Platon symmetry. And as far as I possible, I try to be elementary for non-mathematical audiences. But at some places, I necessary to talk mathematical terminology or mathematical concepts or some results. And if you don't understand this mathematical part, don't worry and ignore it. Since my main purpose is how some idea, mathematical idea, appeared at one point, then how it developed and influenced to each other, and sometimes they split, sometimes they unify, and so on. This stream continues from Platon time, even present time. I want to show that type of history. So even you don't understand mathematical technical details, you may follow this history. That is one apology. The other apology is this is my first time to use TEF for the lecture. I use, of course, TEF for the writing book or writing paper. For the lecture, I don't know. I'm not very skillful for that. So sometimes it may look strange, but please apologize. I use some colors. This is some content. I use some colors in this lecture, and blue and red, most of them no meaning, but maybe red means something related to some historical mathematician or his statement. Blue color usually means more mathematical concept or some mathematical statement, but this is not always true, but roughly, this is a sketch of talk, and we start with Greek time, and after 2,000 years in the Galois type, Galois time, that is the beginning of 19th century, and 40 years later, some Klein's Wilhelm Killing or Felix Klein's work appear, and 60 years later, that means the beginning of this 20th century, some work by Duval and Coxeter. And again, after 40 years, around the 1970, Grothendieck, Briscoe's work appear. And after that, present time, what we are now. And if time allowed, I'll come to here. But it doesn't, maybe we should stop on the way. Yeah. It depends on how the lecture develops. So let's start with the definition of this platonic solid. Platonic solid, or more mathematical terminology, it is called regular polyhedron. That is convex polyhedron whose all faces are congruent regular polygons, which are assembling in the same way around the each vertex. This is defined already Greek time in the Euclid book, and this definition is still valid nowadays. But practically, this means these five figures. This is tetrahedron, cubic, octahedron, dodecahedron, and icosahedron. And there are no more. And already in the Greek time, by, for instance, in the famous book of Euclid, the Stoicheia, written 3 or 4 centuries before, already all these figures are given and attributed to some previous mathematician like Pythagoras or other people. But these figures nowadays are mainly called platonic solid for the reason that these figures in the mythology, in the story, I don't know whether this is real history or not, but in Platon's Academia, they exhibited these old figures, and at the gate, it was written that those who don't understand geometry should not enter Academia. And for this reason, these pictures are called Platonic solid nowadays. In my talk, I'm not mainly considering this geometric figure, but my interest is more talking about symmetry. That means, in modern terminology, the group, in which the concept of group in mathematics appeared around 19th century, Cauchy or these people, yeah. And this concept of group was established by the work of Galois that I shall explain later. But already in these pictures, we see some symmetry. That means you consider that these pictures are embedded in the free space. And you put the center of this figure at the origin of the three-dimensional space. Then you are going to consider the some set of rotations of the three space centered at origin. And this rotation, if rotation brings the figure to itself, let us call it this isomorphism. And this assembling of this all isomorphism makes so-called group. Group means, in mathematical terminology, some object which admit composition of the operation, inverse of the operation. And actually, all isomorphism of such figure form a group. In this case, for so-called tetrahedral group, a cubic group, octahedral group, dodecahedral group, icosahedral group. But if you look at everything from the viewpoint of group, these two are dual. They give the same group. For the reason, if you look at, they are dual to each other in the sense, if you consider the point, the center point of each face, then combining all these points in the center, you obtain octahedron. Oppositely, if you take the point, central point of this octahedron and combine all these figure points, you obtain this cube. That means these are essentially isomorphic from the viewpoint of symmetry. Same thing happened for this dodecahedron and icosahedron. If you take the central points of all faces and connect all these central points, you get this icosahedron. Oppositely, if you take each central point of this icosahedron and connect these central point, you obtain this octadodecahedron. In this sense, these two are same from the viewpoint of symmetry. So later on, I shall not distinguish. Oh, I'm sorry. I got something. No. Yeah, this distinguish. Okay, let's go to further. These are the figures. Of course, later made. This is a figure of Platon, and this is a figure of Euclides. But anyhow, let's go to now. After Euclides or the Greek time, there were not much essential progress understanding this Platonic. I'm sorry.あ、もしもし、ちょっと今まずいので、あ、ちょっとダメ。I'm sorry, some of my friends are calling me.、okay, let's go further. And then also I remark also in the nature, you in the crystals, you find such figures. But I don't want to go much in this direction.Or even in the in nature, some virus has such figure. And also this morning, some of my the researcher in this institute visited my office and showed me her, some figure related to her work, which shows also octahedral cubic symmetry. So such symmetry appears several times in our study. And onestrange example is by Kepler. He tried to explain the planet system using this regular polyhedron, but from the modern viewpoint, his trial was completely stupid. And I should the figure is quite beautiful, but unfortunately, this has no meaning. More meaningful work was done by Euler. Euler gave very remarkable equality like this, where you consider the number of the vertex, number of edges, and the number of faces, and you make plus, minus, plus of these. Then for all tetrahedron cube or octahedron, dodecahedron, icosahedron, you have this number give two. And this phenomenon,is nowadays considered Euler characteristic. Some very initial, very early appearance of some topological structure in the geometry. And nowadays, this Euler characteristic is one of the key techniques to understand varieties. But this is a direction I don't want to discuss today, so I skip more. And then I jump to the Galois time. That is the beginning of the 19th century. And what happened in that time? Maybe I should talk first about solving equation for the unknown number. So suppose you have an unknown number, x, and you want to know this x, what is that? By knowing the relation which x satisfies. For instance,If you have known number A and B, such that AX plus B equals zero, then you can, it is elementary arithmetic that X is solved with. Or in the high school you learn, if your unknown number X satisfies such quadratic equation, AX square plus B times X plus C equals zero, then X has a famous formula for the quadratic equation. And cubic case, I don't write explicitly the formula, but already this formula was known, for instance, in the Islam time. I forgot his name, but famous poetry and famous scholar in the Islam time, he gave this formula also. Also in the Renaissance time, they found also quadratic equation also known in the Renaissance time. I forgot Tartaglia or somebody in that time. But I don't want to write the explicit formula too complicated here. Then how about the higher degree equation? For instance, for given number n, you can consider the equation a0 times x to the power n plus a1 times x n minus 1 plus an equals 0. Then do you know what is x? Can one write down explicitly what is it? There is famous theorem Gauss that such number, if you are this given number, so-called complex numbers, then always there are n number of solution of this polynomial. But then only Gauss said only existence. Can one write down explicitly like this formula, only using so-called addition, multiplication, subtraction, or using only nth root? Can one write down the x? And this was known until the Abel and Galois time. That is really the beginning of 19th century. And complete answer was given by Galois. Or maybe I show the figures. Unfortunately, he died when he was 21. Because of this, I don't know how to say in English. There is some fight here. And but his what he has done was really revolutionary. Even nowadays, many people admire him, and I'm sure that he is one of the greatest mathematicians in our history. And what he has done is the following: instead of by the way, you don't need to read the text. Most of the text I'll explain orally. And if necessary, I show by this pointer the some point. So please just hear what I'm saying. So Galois' case, his viewpoint is different than the predecessor's. Predecessor was looking some directly the number you want to know. But Galois' case, he don't look at just each individual numbers, but he begin to look at the system of all numbers who are related to this equation. This is nowadays called field in the mathematical terminology, field. That means you look at the system of numbers which is closed by addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. And such system is number. For instance, all rational numbers are field. If you add some algebra numbers, solution of algebraic equation only, this forms some algebraic number field, etc. All real numbers are again field like this. And Galois consider if you start with some number field which are related to the equation, and you begin to add step by step, square root, cube root, or whatever necessary, and look at the extend the field. And this extension system was completely described in terms of so-called Galois group. Group in this case appears as the isomorphism of the field. So before I was talking isomorphism of platonic solid, and you consider the set of all rotation preserve the same figure. And in this Galois case, more abstract, the system of numbers is called field, whether one system is isomorphic to the other system. Just you don't ask which number it is. Just you ask whether addition, multiplication, or this structure are preserved from one to the other. This viewpoint is quite close to the modern viewpoint of category. In this last century, this sort of idea is quite quickly developing in mathematics, but Galois contained already the idea of category, I'm sure. But anyhow, he looked at the group of isomorphisms. For instance, for the given For instance, for the given equation, you consider just some number field related to this, only these coefficients and rational number. And then look at, again, extension, adding possible solution for this equation and so on. Then I'm very roughly explaining, don't worry that I'm not precise. But anyhow, then he introduced isomorphism, such group is called Galois group. And some structure, if the Galois group has some particular structure, which is nowadays called solvable, then this equation can be solved only by using nth root. And even nowadays, people found another formula, for instance, using hypergeometric function or many other elliptic function, using such particular function, there is some formula to describe this solution. But if you restrict yourself only algebraic operation like nth root, Galois group should be so-called solvable group, some very particular structure. That was his answer. Then for the polynomials of equation of degree less than 4 are all solvable. But the equation for degree 5, this unsolvable group appears. This unsolvable, there are several possible unsolvable groups, but I'm now going to talk about A5. A5 is some unsolvable group of rotation, permutation of 5 elements corresponding to 5 solution of degree 5. And this A5 is strangely appearing in the Platonic solution. That is a viewpoint of the next stage done by the Galois, not Galois, but Felix Klein. So let's come to the Felix Klein. Oh, before coming Felix Klein, I should talk about a little bit Galois' idea. He, as I told you, he died early, but his work was published by, I think it was Hermite or somebody who collected his papers and published in the, I forgot, published 1846. But his work was hard to understand. Even the same time, Gauss or Cauchy or the biggest mathematician at that time, Jacob, didn't understand, unfortunately. But nevertheless, his work began to influence on geometry and analysis. And 40 years later, than after Galois, this works of Klein and Lee appeared. But before coming, I just want to mention 4 items, the Platonic symmetry and Kleinian singularity, Hochstadt-Dinkin diagram. I shall explain all these items later more carefully, but and a simple Lie algebra. These are mathematical of the Platonic solid. Kleinian singularity, Hochstadt-Dinkin diagram, simply. And later on, I show all these 4 items are from the viewpoint of category. They are equivalent objects. That means Platonic solid symmetry appears in all these other things. And that is one main subject what I'm going to talk. And my question is, what is the next stage? But that is another question I shall discuss later. So let's first come to the case of Felix Klein and Sophie Slee, and later by Wilhelm Killing. So before coming to the description of what Klein and Lee did, this is a figure. This is Felix Klein, one of the biggest leaders in the in this time. Sophie Slee is one of the founder of the most basic concept, D-algebra, and even nowadays, one of the very quite important subject. And Killing is some person who make available his D theory to the modern style. But anyhow, I shall discuss later. And I want to just first look at the introduction of the book written by Felix Klein when he wrote his famous book. Before coming to his book on the icosahedron, he wrote very one of, even nowadays, the people are reading. This is more than 100 years old. Still, people are interested in again published and referred and work. There are many works still concerning this icosahedron's work. The reason is the following. The symmetry of this icosahedron, I was talking at the beginning. If you look at the symmetry group of icosahedron, that group is in the modern terminology written A5. Symmetric, not permutation, index 2 subgroup of permutation group of 5, this A5. This icosahedral group is exactly the group of some Galois group of degree 5. So they are the same group. Using this fact, Klein was writing very careful study of geometric connection, algebra, and geometry. That was this icosahedron. But in his introduction, he was writing the following. My indebtedness to Professor Lee, dated back to the year 1869 to 70, when we were spending the last period of our student life in Berlin and Paris together in intimate camaradeship. At that time, we jointly conceived the scheme of investigating geometric or analytic form susceptible of transformation by means of groups of changes. This purpose has been of directing influence in our subsequent labors, though these may have appeared to lie far asunder. Whilst I primarily directed my attention to groups of discrete operations and was thus led to the investigation of regular solids and their relation to the theory of equations, that is what I just mentioned here, Professor Lee attacked the more recondite theory of continued group of transformation and therewith of different equations, differential equations. Okay, so in this way, Felix Klein described they got the same idea to use Galois, the idea in geometry and analysis, but they go different direction in the sense that Klein goes to the discrete direction and D goes to the continuous direction. But I shall explain this more carefully later, that actually their work after 60 years again meet by the other mathematician, which I call Coxeter and Duval, and much later by Griscom and Grotandi. So first, let me explain what they have done. So Klein's case, I mentioned already, he was looking at this isomorphism group of regular polyhedrons. And it's a little bit, again, technical, so you don't need to follow mathematical details, but at least I should explain mathematically. So he considers a group of rotation of three dimension, which preserves some regular polyhedron. Then obviously this group acts not only the regular solid, but the total space of three dimensional space as a rotation here. Then maybe you know, already learn in the school that in the such three space, you have Descartes Cartesian coordinate x, y, z, z. Using x, y, z coordinate, you can consider this group of rotation studied by Klein acts on the space of all polynomial function on this space, three variable polynomial. Then Klein was, as according to the guiding principle, one should look at the invariance of this action. And he came to the that invariant polynomial in these three variables are not unique, but there are many, many. But finally, he found there are three basic invariants, so that all other invariants are described by only addition or multiplication of these basic invariants. So he got three basic invariants, even a little bit confusing, but let us call these three polynomials, which are invariant by the this regular polyhedral group, let us call x, y, z. Then, moreover, Klein found these three polynomials are not independent. They have relations. In the modern terminology, he was looking at the Syzygy resolution of these groups, but it's a little bit technical and I don't go to detail, but he found relation between these basic invariants, and these relations are the following. For the maybe for the icosahedral group, this is the relation between this octahedral group, dodecahedral group. And as I said at the beginning, in the classification of all regular polyhedron, I said there are two dihedron and unihedron. So unihedron and dihedron case, these are the invariants. And these look like not particular, just elementary simple polynomial. Nevertheless, in the sequel, people found these described the D theory. But before come, let us give table A means this. This polynomial, I am going to call this polynomial Kleinian singularity. So I put not polynomial, Kleinian polynomial, but Kleinian singularity for the reason that maybe I just explain for the reason. If you have a polynomial in typically in the two variable case, F equals zero may have some singular point. That means it is not smooth, but there are some cusp or some irregular point. And that is called singularity. So Klein's polynomial, three variables, if you look at carefully, the zero locus defines a surface in the hypersurface in the three space. Since three variables, you get hypersurface in the three space. Then you observe that this surface, I cannot draw a picture, it's too much complicated. They are smooth except at the origin. At the origin, there are very complicated singularities, which I don't describe. For that reason, these polynomials are called Kleinian singularities. So at least we come some Platon's solid in one-to-one correspondence with Klein's singularity. Let us call this equivalence class table A. In the D case is more difficult to explain. His work is more closely related to differential geometry, contact structure, or whatever. And this is too I need 1 hour, another lecture to explain this, so I don't want to go detail. But in Lee case, this continuous group, he studied not Klein's case, discrete, yeah, group are jumping, elements are jumping, but Lee case, he was considering group which is continuous, yeah. Then he look at the some central point, some unit element of the group. And then he look at infinitesimally what happened in the neighborhood of the D group. And this concept lead him to the so-called D algebra. And D algebra is one of the fundamental tools in the mathematics, even nowadays in physics and mathematics, and also many deep theory, representation theory are developing now, even nowadays. But I don't want to go detail. This D algebra in general is too general. But then 20 years later than D, Wilhelm Killing come to the classification of what nowadays people call simple Lie groups. That means the group which doesn't have some so-called normal subgroup. I don't want to explain what is normal subgroup. And how simple he begins to classify all simple objects in the Lie theory. And he found all these simple groups are classified by so-called root system. And I don't want to explain what is root system here, but just a few words I can. This study of Killing was looking at the abelian sub abelian means commutative subgroup subalgebra of the group, and he looked at the action of this abelian part on itself, so-called adjoint action, and look at the eigenspaces, eigenequation. Then solution of this eigenequation are called roots. In that sense, he called root system. And strangely, this system of roots describes completely classify all simple Lie algebra. And later on, I shall later on refer Coxeter that this simple root system, finite root system, are described by classified by diagram, so-called Coxeter diagram. So instead of writing explicitly the Lie algebra, I'm going to list up all Coxeter-Denkin diagram, Coxeter type A, B, C, D, F, G. This is a list. And later on, if I have a time, I'll explain what this diagram originally means and what it shall imply later on. But this is some standard data when nowadays people study Lie algebra. Okay, this, but then we have established some relationship between this Coxeter-Denkin diagram and so Coxeter-Denkin diagram, simple Lie algebra in one to one, since they are classified. So let us call table B. So I made two tables, table A and B. Table A, you remember, it was the relation between Kleinian singularity and Kleinian Platon solid. This is some list of the Platon solid. And table B is a list of this simple Lie algebra and Coxeter-Denkin diagram. And of course, they look completely different. Can one find any relation between table A and table B? Apparently, they look completely different. But after 60 years, and half one century later, Duval, I'll explain, Duval showed that table A implied table B. And even 40 years later, Briscoe showed table A, table B implies table A. Let me explain what are those implications. By the way, in this list of Coxeter-Denkin diagram, there are A, B, C, D, F, G. So there are too many compare the Klein's platonic solid table. And the reason is the following. Here we have diagram which contain not only simple edge, but double edge or triple edge. And these diagram with double edge or triple edge are obtained by folding this simple edge diagram. I don't want to explain detail. So we shall consider essentially only the simple edge diagram. That means A type, D type, and E type. And then list of this diagram number exactly fit with the list of the Kleinian singularity, but that we shall see later. Let's go to the machine doesn't accept. So I'm going to explain these implications, table A to table B and table B to table A. So first come to the table A to B by the Duval and Coxeter. And these mathematicians were active in the first half of the 20th century. And it is really marvelous coincidence that they are together in the 33 or 4, I forgot, in the Cambridge Trinity College. And they found that what they are studying are exactly the same object. But let me explain what I mean. Unfortunately, in the Wikipedia, I couldn't find the figure of Duval. So I took only the Coxeter's figure. But anyhow, these people are the next main actors. Let me explain what they have done. In the Coxeter case, he was studying the group of action on the Euclidean space generated by what is called reflection. Reflection means if there is a hyperplane, then you make a mirror symmetry. The left side goes to right side goes to left side. This reflection is obviously an isomorphism of this Euclidean space. Then you are going to consider the group which are generated by this reflection. Then Coxeter finds how to classify such groups. He has a very nice technique. I don't want to go too much detailed, but roughly speaking, the following. If you have a group generated by reflection and in under suitable good action, you consider all reflection which appears in the group. That cuts the Euclidean space in small pieces. And then you choose just one component, so-called unconnected component called chamber. And then wall of chamber corresponding to some system of reflection. Then the group is generated by that system. And Coxeter finds using some angles of this two reflection hyperplane, you can describe the group. That is a way. So I don't want to explain more detail, but anyhow, that technique allows him to list up these diagrams for the reflection group, which appeared in the study of the algebra. In this, in the Killing's work, I was not explaining details, but Killing was studying so-called root system. At that time, he came also the reflection action defined by this root. And this reflection group is nowadays called Weyl group, but this Weyl group class, okay. Anyhow, so this is what Cox described, his technique using this reflection group, this diagram he obtained. That is a Coxeter part. But in the same time, in the okay, thank you. But what is strange is this more strange is the study of Duval. Duval look at this what I call Klein's singularity. That means a hypersurface defined by the Klein's polynomial. It's too complicated, so I cannot draw a picture, but in the it has a singular point. But in the early beginning of 20th century, there were some group of Italian mathematicians who were studying surfaces, beautiful study of surface by Castelnuovo or many other people. And they developed some very special technique to study the singular point of surface. Namely, that is a resolution of the singularity. Means if you have such surface singularity point, then you blowing up, that means replace this point by a circle, by a curve, then you get some smooth surface. So S is the original singular surface, S tilde, this is the blowing up. This is the most elementary case, but in general, only one curve C is not sufficient. Growing up singularity, you need some system of C1 to CN, some system of curve. And then Duval look at this Klein singularity, and he list up all resolutions of all these singularities. Then he want to describe this system of curves more symbolically. And he came to the idea, if you have a system of curves, maybe I hope I wrote somewhere. This system of curves, C1 to CK, these are so-called exceptional curves. Then he make a diagram associated to this system. Namely, for each curve CI, you associate one vertex. I thought somewhere I described this diagram construction. So for each CI, you associate diagram VI. Then if C, two curves CI and CJ are crossing to each other, non-trivial intersection, then you put some edge between vertex VI and VJ. In this way, for all Kleinian singularity, Duval list up all these diagrams. Then strange thing happened. Duval noticed surprisingly that the tree's diagram, that is what I just explained, he obtained was the same tree diagram which were obtained by Coxeter. Coxeter studying the reflection group. He used diagram to describe the reflection group. But Duval was studying the resolution of singularity. He used the diagram. Both diagrams coincided. That is some surprising thing. That means Kleinian singularity, starting Kleinian singularity, using the resolution, you obtain Coxeter-Dickin diagram. So if you look at the London Journal of Mathematics written in the 1933 or 4, I forgot, I look at this book carefully, then Duval was writing that it may be noticed that trees of curves which we have had to consider bare, consider that this is a tree mean Duval's diagram. Yeah? Bear a strict formal resemblance to the spherical simplex whose angle are some multiple of pi considered by Coxeter. That means he is saying that the world diagram coincides resemblance, he said, only resemblance of the Coxeter diagram. And in the same volume of the London Mathematical Journal in the 1933 or 4, Coxeter also was writing in the same time in the Trinity College, and Duval wrote in the volume, Coxeter wrote, according to a request of Duval, I will list up the groups generated by reflection. So Duval suggested to look at such diagram, what are the groups, and Coxeter get the list, which I mentioned already before. Yeah? So if you look at the paper of Coxeter, you get this diagram. But not only this, but Coxeter gave more diagram according to some other reason. But anyhow, in this way, the implication happened. That means Kleinian singularity determines the Coxeter diagram. That means Kleinian regular polyhedron or regular solid determines the D-algebra. You got this direction. This is what happened in the 1933-4 in the Trinity College. But at that time, Duval wrote only the strict resemblance. That is only the symbolical coincidence of the diagram. But 40 years later, in the time early 70 or end of 69, this was not resemblance, but really geometric background that was found by Briscoe and Grothendieck. So let me explain what this is, Briscoe and Grothendieck. By the way, Briscoe was my mentor, my teacher. Okay. And let me explain what happened. Yeah, it's again mathematical technical thing, so I cannot go too much details, but Briscoe was studying around the end of 1960s, some resolution, simultaneous resolution of the Duval singularities. That is a more careful study of this Kleinian singularity. And I cannot, there are many small details, but I don't want to go detail. But Briscoe found, in order to describe the resolution of the singularity, he was necessary to use the data of the associated this simple D algebra. That was very strange. For instance, there is some covering construction, etc. I don't want more geometric construction. He was necessary to use simple D algebra. And at that time, he was also in, it was exactly the end of the Vietnam War time, and many people run away from US. And in Paris, Briscoe, Grothendieck, these people are together. And Briscoe consulted to Grothendieck, what happened? What is this? And then after some time discussion, finally they are successful to construct all Duval, Kleinian singularities using simple D algebra. That construction is a little bit technical, and I don't want to describe, but at least some implication. Simple D algebra, using simple D algebra, you obtain Kleinian singularity inside this D algebra. More precisely, this simple D algebra as a set, it's a big vector space, but inside that there is so-called nilpotent element, nilpotent subvariety. an nilpotent sub-variety as non-smooth and singular variety. But if you look at the generic point of this nilpotent variety, you obtain the Kleinian singular. That is a structure that I skip. So in this way, all these four objects are coincident. We started with a platonic solid symmetry, and Felix Klein used this symmetry to look at the invariant polynomial, and the invariant polynomial defined what is Kleinian singularity, some polynomial. Then Duval studied the resolution of this Kleinian singularity, then get Coxeter-Denkin diagram. On the other hand, this Coxeter's work showed that this Coxeter-Denkin diagram, or Killing's work, showed that they are classifying simple D algebra. On the other hand, Briscoe and Grothendieck showed simple D algebra constructs a Kleinian singularity. In this way, all these four objects are somehow equivalent data. One determines the other, and cyclically. So this is a story happened around the beginning of 70. And I want to add one more comment on this phenomenon. The relation between this Kleinian singularity and Coxeter-Denkin diagram. I mentioned Duval's work, how this implies this, but this was using resolution of the singularity. But there is another approach using the smoothing of the singularity. That is the following. Before, when I was explaining, Duval said was doing resolution on singularity. Let us remember what was resolution. Here. If you have a singular variety, just blowing up some singular point and you obtain smooth space. This is a way. And usually this is not a single curve, but system of curves. That is the what Duval does. But there is another viewpoint, what I meant to call smoothing. So let us consider the same problem. Suppose you have here a singular point, which is a singular point at the origin, singular surface with a singular point at the origin. Then this, suppose this singular variety defined by a polynomial f equals zero, then you are going to consider f equals one. I'm sorry, I forgot to put f equals one and f equals zero. But then this picture surrounding this smooth picture is supposed is defined f equals one. Then this is somehow smoothing of this original singular point. This is more from the viewpoint of deformation, not the resolution, but deformation. But strangely, in the deformation, you look some homological cycles here, which look like quite dual to what Duval described in his resolution. This cycle is called vanishing cycle. And then this idea, more in general, was studied by Milner. He showed that in general, in any low isolated singular point, f equals zero, or there is always some vanishing cycles of certain size. I don't want to explain details, but some vanishing cycle for the singularity. And in this way, he found some possible candidate which described the root system. And at the Milner's time, it was not clear. He studied this work in the 1969, But 20 years later, in the end of last century, in the 1995 or 6, I forgot, there are new trends in mathematical physics where these two objects, resolution and deformation, can be understood. Resolution is more complex geometric object, and deformation, this, the vanishing cycle, are concept of more symplectic geometry. Then mathematical physics suggested that there is some duality between symplectic geometry and complex geometry. That is nowadays called mirror symmetry. And mirror symmetry is one of the most mysterious symmetries which people still try to understand. We don't have complete understanding. Nevertheless, there are basic work by Konsevich or Yao and these people. They try to understand geometrical or categorical. And we are still on the way. But anyhow, there is some duality between the dual approach and Milner's approach. That is the point I want to add. So far, I explained the history, and this is my next paragraph is what I have done after this, but I'm afraid there is no more time. I don't know. If you give me 2-3 minutes, oh, this is Milner. I just will explain. Okay, so thank you very much. So then I come to the new concept, elliptic singularity and elliptic root system. In the previous table C, which I explained before, let's come back again to see. Yeah, we saw some equivalence of four objects. Singularities, some symmetry group, or Coxeter diagram, simple realgebra. I'm going in the shortly after this Briscoe and Grothendieck's work, I came to construct some generalization of this Kleinian singularity, which I call elliptic singularity for several reasons. And this elliptic singularity I shall give later, just in the table. But then it is a natural question, what are the four corresponding other parts? For instance, what are the, this Platonic symmetry? Whether, since all Platonic symmetry are classified, is there anything more? And actually it exists. Corresponding to the elliptic singularity, which I studied, I showed later. This symmetry is planar symmetry. That means this Platonic symmetry is a symmetry of rotation of spheres, but there are symmetry group on the plane, how plane acts symmetry. And planar symmetry theory corresponds to the elliptic singularity. And then I'm going to find this, what are the diagrams for the root system and what are the simple realgebra? That let me show the table. So around 74, I came to these three polynomials. Yeah, that look like very similar to the Kleinian singularity, but some the power are a little bit bigger. In the Kleinian singularity, these are some 5, 6 or whatever, but this becomes bigger. And then for these correspond to the Platon symmetry, correspond to the Heisenberg group symmetry. Kleinian singularity correspond to this. I call these singularity elliptic. Yeah? Then elliptic the singularity. Then most important, now I want to explain. Then what are the Coxeter-Denikin diagram? What are the root system Since all classical finite loop systems are classically classified by Turing and Cartan, it should be the end. But there are infinite root systems which are still classified by generalization of Coxeter-Denkin diagram. So I should give some tables. These are the some tables of this elliptic diagram. And if I have time, I could explain detail. This connection shows some what are the radical and what is happening. What and this shows very close connection also the platonic symmetry, but I cannot explain now so quickly. So I just show the some tables of this all symmetry. And this is the end. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. I'm sorry, one thing. And elliptic realgebra are also just described last year using very strong radical extension in some finite algebra. But that is another subject which we should discuss.
Thank you. Any questions for Professor Saito? So I wanted to ask one quick. Go ahead, Mark.
How does this relate to the Mackay classification of singularities?
A Mackay case is this finite type case. Yeah, they are. You are talking classical Mackay, yeah?
Yeah. As simple as possible, please.
Yeah, classical Mackay correspond means you look at the character for the this regular polyhedral group, and this basis of character described exactly the Coxeter-Denkin diagram. That is a Mackay case. Then, instead of that, as I showed you here, in the Mackay case, he used a regular polyhedral group of the symmetry of polyhedron. But if you look at the Heisenberg group of very particular type, which I used for the description of elliptic singularities, and you look at the character of this Heisenberg group, then again you obtain diagram like this. Yeah, that is again very another aspect I skipped. Yeah.
Hi. You mentioned mathematical physics towards the end.
Yeah.
I'm curious what kind of physical systems do these singularities arise in?
I don't say directly this singularity corresponds to some physical system, but what I mentioned about this mirror symmetry, I should better professor ask. Consult Professor Hikami, but this appeared in high energy physics, and I know only mathematical size. Yeah, and at least I don't. Of course, I know in the string models. Yeah, there are 26 dimensional space and compactification. I'm not expert, but in this model there are. Type B2 models and type D model might be connected to these singularities, but better not ask me, but more expert. Yeah, I'm sorry.
So can I ask a quick question about this classification? So with the usual, say, simple Lie algebras, somehow type A is the most natural, or similarly with the Coxeter groups, type A is always type the easiest to study, right? So what is your analogous thing? Is this type A?
Type A, yeah.
So do you think this should somehow be easy to study these elliptic Lie algebras, elliptic groups, anything starting with
that
type A?
That is you can build something? Long question, hard question. This is still just started, and I cannot answer definitely. But our experience shows that strange that this rank one case, it, in principle, usually this sort of thing is the most simplest case, easy case, but it often the case in the study of elliptic root system, rank one case like this or this one, behaves very exceptionally. I don't know, for instance, modular group, elliptic modular group acts on this root system. Yeah? And this, that makes theory quite modular invariant theory. That means the elliptic modular theory. But this structure for this exceptional rank one cases, structure is more complicated. I don't know the reason. That is more experience of my collaborator, Yoshisa Saito, or Iohara told me that what they think that they are very particular. Nevertheless, of course, I'm sure it should be quite interesting to look at carefully. Already in this case, you may spend years to understand. It should contain many, many interesting structures, but I cannot answer.
Does that mean you think the rank two type A case should be simpler or even
in
crazier?
In some sense, the general case is more some general framework of theory works. And this case needs some particular treatment.
Thank you. If there are no further questions, then let's thank Professor Saito again. Thank you all for joining.